Let me just say a few words in introducing our panelists, and then we'll turn the floor over to them for remarks, followed by questions and answers. President Carroll is beginning her 23rd year as president of Dominican University. A comprehensive Catholic university of 3,500 students located west of Chicago. Donna Carroll was the first lay president of the institution that was founded in 1901 by the Sinsinawa Dominican Sisters. In 1997, she led the community through a successful name change from Rosary College, in a school basically known as the Library Science School, to Dominican University. Today, under her leadership, Dominican is ranked by U.S. News and World Report among the top 20 master's level universities in the Midwest, and by bestcolleges.com as one of the top Catholic universities in the United States. Prior to coming to Dominican, she served as secretary of the university for the Rams of Fordham University and vice president, dean of the college, and dean of students at Mount Vernon College in Washington, D.C. She is identified regularly as one of the 100 women of influence by Crane Chicago Business, Today's Chicago Women, and among the top 10 women in education by the Chicago Sun-Times. She is an outspoken advocate for immigration reform and the rights of undocumented students. Dr. Carroll will speak to us briefly, and then she'll be followed with remarks by President Dave Parkyn, who's the president of North Park University. He has been the president since 2006. Prior to that, he was the provost and senior vice president at Elizabethtown College. And prior to that, he served on the faculty and administrative appointments at Messiah College. By vocation an educator, President Parkyn has dedicated his career to teaching undergrads and leading institutions of higher learning. He has his Bachelor of Arts from Messiah College, a Master of Divinity from Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary, a Doctor of Philosophy from Boston College. President Parkyn was raised in Guatemala as the son of church workers, and one of his scholarly interests is religion in Latin America. We're proud to have President Parkyn and President Carroll with us today. And President Carroll, do you want to lead off?
Good afternoon. And thank you for coming here to support, or at least to be curious about, the value of a liberal arts and sciences education in the state of Illinois. I consider it a high impact, adaptable, and often misunderstood sector. And so it's a delight to have the opportunity to talk about it and discuss the sector with you. Now, since I'm the president of a Catholic liberal arts university, let me start with a confession. I am so glad that we postponed this session from October to January. Because last October, the Times headline, the Trib headline, questioned the return on investment of a liberal arts degree the day before we were about to speak. In contrast, last week, the Trib reported a record gap in job access and life income, 56%, between college grads and students who do not have a college degree. So in my world, it's a good week for the academy. But it's still important to be accountable to the skeptics. And And we, small liberal arts universities, need to increasingly differentiate ourselves from what I call the big box solutions. And if you read this morning's front article, you understand that differential. So again, I'm delighted to have time to do that. The word liberal, by the way, comes from the Latin, liberalis, and it has to do with freedom and generosity of thought, which is a privilege in our democratic society and something we should foster in all walks of education and never take for granted. A bit more about me. We were asked to each introduce ourselves. Yes, I am in my 23rd year as president. Yes, that means I have been president longer than most of my undergraduate students have been alive. I am an 18th century English literature major from Wellesley. I have a master's in higher ed and a doctorate in counseling psychology, which explains my interest in ideas and people. I began my career in student affairs. I moved into academic administration. Then I moved into fundraising and governance. I'm a New Yorker by birth. I moved from Massachusetts to Ohio to New Jersey to Washington, D.C. to New York, and now to Illinois, which I consider my West Coast experience. and I have, I believe, overseen a great deal of change in higher education, and specifically at my small university that has moved from an undergraduate college to a comprehensive, now doctoral granting university. And as it was said, on May in 2017, we celebrate the 20th anniversary of our name change from Rosary College to Dominican University. So we're very excited about that. Why Dominican? Why so long? People often ask. My answer is, I came for the responsibility, I stayed for the mission and the impact that our sector has on the lives of students. Dominican is a Catholic Dominican institution. It began in Cincinnati, Wisconsin. We've been 10 miles west of downtown in River Forest since 1922. We are now about 3,700 students, about 2,300 undergrads, 53% Pell eligible, and just about the same first generation to college students, undergrad. We are proud of our rank as a top 20 Midwest. We're one of four private Hispanic serving institutions in the state of Illinois. Tuition is about $30,000. Our net tuition is about $15,200. And our loan default is about 3-4%. It moves in that direction. So in other words, Dominican is, I like to say, a high achieving, highly personal, relatively low-cost university that specializes not only in the education but in the graduation of a diverse first-generation student body. And David and I share that in common. So my job is to set the context, to give you a few numbers, and to put on the table a few myths, and then David will fill in the blanks. There are about 100 private colleges and universities in Illinois. Most of them are liberal arts at their core. The ACI colleges that we represent are about a fourth of that, about 25 of those colleges. Together, private higher education educates about 250,000 students every year. We graduate about 65,000 students each year. We award over $1 billion in private grants and scholarships annually. We educate about 20% of all undergraduates in Illinois, almost 60% of graduate students. And we award, and this often surprises people, half of the undergraduate degrees to students of color in the state. 50% of the undergraduate degrees to students of color in the state. We also offer 2/3 of the graduate degrees for a diverse student body. So in that context, let me play with five myths. There are many myths about that often challenge our sense of identity. and let me correct them and offer them as a place for more conversation. The first one is that private colleges are not affordable. That's not true. The net tuition of a private college or university in Illinois is usually about 50% of the published price. My tuition is about $30,000. We offer over $15,000 in grants, and so our tuition, net tuition, is about $15,000. The average grant of a student in a private university in Illinois is about $15,000. So we are affordable. In fact, we're about the same cost as the University of Illinois. The second myth is that private colleges only educate white, wealthy, traditional students. That is not true. Ethnically, economically, we are as diverse as the public institutions, and in fact, the small ACI colleges are even more diverse. And over 40% of the families across private higher education have family incomes of less than $40,000. As I mentioned, we are 53% Pell eligible. That is a family income of less than 40. So we do educate a very diverse student body. The third myth is that, one of my favorite, that graduates leave with at least $100,000 in debt. Right. The reality is that the average debt, cumulative debt, of a student from a private institution is about $30,000. The average debt of a student from a public institution is about $24,000. The price of a car. My student debt load is about $25,000. And what you have to put into the picture is the understanding that the graduation rates at most private liberal arts colleges, and I would say particularly at many of our ACI colleges, is higher than the public sector and higher across the board. What's the worst case scenario? Student debt and no degree. An ACI institution not only provides a quality education, but a higher likelihood of graduation on time and the ability to use your degree. The final myth is that a college degree is no longer a good investment. Thank goodness we had that article earlier today. But we know that a college degree, over a lifetime, a student with a college degree typically earns $1 million to $1.2 million more than a student without a degree. As the Trib reported earlier, the differential is 56% right now. The other factor that's important is the unemployment rate of a college student is 4 to 5% lower than students across the board. And then one more myth. All private colleges have billion-dollar endowments. I wish that were the case. Actually, 44 of 1,600 private institutions across the country have billion-dollar endowments. The average endowment of a private institution is about $25,000. So these are $25 million. Sorry. It feels like $25,000.
A lot of hard stuff here.
So what's the moral of my story in the context? Don't believe what you hear about every institution. Each sector is different, with different strengths and different opportunities. Recognize that private higher education has made an enormous commitment to this state and to our students. And don't discount the little guys. We make a big contribution, not only to the quality of the life of the individual student, but to the character and the citizenry of the state and to the economy. Thank you.
David Parkyn, president of North Park University. Your turn.
Thank you. Well, good afternoon. I echo Donna's words of delight in the invitation to be with you this afternoon. I'm going to follow a pattern similar to what Donna approached to tell you just a little bit about myself, something about the school that I am affiliated with and work with, and then build on Donna's comments to talk some about the outcomes of education from schools like ours, and also a bit about how we approach that and the avenues by which we achieve those outcomes. 47 years ago, in 1970, I was one of two students from my high school graduating class to attend college. No one from my family had ever before set foot on a college campus, and yet I set out with this dream, certainly against some significant odds. How was I able to succeed in the foreign land of the academy, in a culture that in fact was so different from anything I or my family had ever known? On the day I arrived at college, my parents were so out of their element on the campus that once they had put my suitcase and the one other bag that I had brought with me on the sidewalk outside of my residence hall, they simply drove away. Hanging around the campus for a day of orientation to college life was simply too much for my parents to get their arms around. Yes, I felt abandoned, totally alone. Perhaps I've forgiven my mother and my father by now for their failed moment of parenting, I'm not sure. What I do know is this: at the beginning of every school year, when I greet students coming to campus for the first time, I always watch out for that family that is showing some evidence of being out of their element. I've promised myself and my campus that there will be no students abandoned on the sidewalks of North Park. I survived my first year because, quite accidentally and totally without any significant input or insight on my part, I chose to attend a liberal arts college. That's why I succeeded, why I survived. I also chose to study history. I graduated a few years later and took my first job, laying sewer pipe for a new residential community out there in the suburbs. This is all true. Other than that year in the sewers and a few years at a research university completing my doctoral program, I've spent my entire professional life on campuses of liberal arts colleges in Massachusetts, in Pennsylvania, and in Illinois now. This has been my professional home as a faculty member and as an administrator. North Park University here in Chicago was established 125 years ago in the middle of a cabbage and onion patch beyond the end of the trolley line. Since then, Chicago has grown, and in growing, it came around our campus, put its arms around our campus, and we have become an urban institution on the north side of the city. Years ago, pilots that were landing planes at Orchard Field, now O'Hare Airport, used to use, we're told, the cupola of Old Main on our campus as a point to assure proper alignment with the runway. Technology has been improved. The school was founded by a Swedish immigrant church community. 5 years after coming to America, they started a college. Well, not really a college, but a school that has become a college. The early curriculum was limited to preparation for church ministry, as you might expect, and to commerce. The language of instruction was Swedish. Of course, much, much, much has changed in the intervening 125 years. Today, our school is comprised of some 3,200 students completing both undergraduate and graduate degrees in an array of applied fields, along with the arts and the sciences. Much like the experience at Dominican, student demographics at North Park today have shifted rapidly as well, reflecting the evolving face of America. In 1995, the Board of Trustees at North Park pledged, made a commitment to increase the diversity of our students on our campus, and today, both in our undergraduate programs and in our graduate programs, students are majority-minority. The university's curriculum is organized around 5 professional schools, along with a College of Arts and Sciences. This continued commitment to the presence of the arts and sciences in the context of applied areas of study is what fosters our identity in the liberal arts. Yet the nature of learning at North Park is not best understood by perusing our academic catalog or finding out what the names of all the courses are that are offered. Rather, the education that's offered at North Park and at places like North Park is best understood by focusing on the shape of the student experience. And that's what I want to talk about for a bit. What identifies and strengthens the student experience at liberal arts colleges, like Dominican University and North Park University and all of the schools with the Associated Colleges of Illinois, what identifies and strengthens the student experience at liberal arts schools is an intentional learning strategy with what I'm going to suggest today are 3 foci, 3 focal points. Perhaps consider this a 3-legged stool, if you need an image, a 3-legged stool of learning at liberal arts colleges, each with legs of equal length and each with legs of equivalent importance. One leg of this stool of learning represents, as we would expect, the formally taught curriculum. What liberal arts colleges do is that they assure that regardless of the student's major, each student's academic experience begins through learning in a broad array of fields, which serve then as a foundation for learning that becomes much more specialized and much deeper as a student engages their major study. We call this general education. Many of you know of that. Students often misrepresent this part of the curriculum as simply something that you want to get out of the way as quickly as you can so you can move on to the more important stuff. But general education at places like North Park and Dominican ACI institutions actually becomes the root around which we frame the type of learning that we hope takes place in the lives of our students and to which we ascribe as a liberal arts institution. A second leg of this school is relational. At liberal arts colleges, we hold to the ideal that learning is a communal activity, a social activity. It's always done in the presence of others. So liberal arts colleges put a lot of time and emphasis into fostering relationships. Relationships between students and their peers, relationships between students and all of those who educate them on our campuses, faculty members and coaches and mentors and professionals in our areas of student life and so on, and relationships between students and members of the broader community. This is deeply important to us. Members of the broader community, our neighborhood, our cities, in which the learning on our campus is best located. These are reasons why at North Park we often say Chicago is our classroom and all Chicagoans are our teachers. We also say at North Park, I frequently remind all of us who work at North Park that our principal responsibility, regardless of whatever it is that's placed in our respective position description, our principal responsibility is simply to walk alongside our students. Why? Because learning at liberal arts colleges is deeply relational. The third leg of the school is experiential. That is, not all of learning takes place in the traditional formal classroom, the place where students come in, sit down, take notes as a wise person speaks. No, it's much more than that. The experiential aspect of learning is one that all of higher education, but especially liberal arts colleges, have come to understand and engage in much more than they ever have in recent years. A leader in this endeavor is an assessment project known as NESE, the National Survey of Student Engagement. And one aspect of the NESE project is an attempt at an effort to identify five types of educational experiences, five types of what they call high-impact learning experiences that have been confirmed as being especially enriching and indeed life-changing for students that participate in them. I'll review them with you just really, really quickly. Participating in a learning community, that is gathering with a small group of students, 15 or so, and taking more than one course together. Engaging in field experiences, largely in the workplace, internships, clinical assignments, if you're, say, in the health professions, student teaching and nursing, et cetera, across all parts of the campus learning environment. Third one is participating in a study abroad experience. For however long it is, doing it for a short time is better than doing it not at all. A fourth thing is collaborating in a very close working relationship with a faculty member to undertake a shared research project. And the last one is completing a culminating senior experience, a capstone project of sorts in which the student makes an effort to bring together and to integrate learning from across their entire educational experience. Here's the catch. These types of educational experiences often require considerable time and effort. They always reach beyond the four walls of the classroom. They necessitate significant interaction between faculty members and their students. They encourage collaboration with others, especially people who are different from who you are. And they mandate very frequent and substantial feedback. As a result, some institutions work on these more successfully than others because of the deep time commitment and resource effort that it takes to complete such such deep kinds of learning experiences. And what NESE has established and found is that these practices are most profoundly expressed and most successfully undertaken in the context of liberal arts colleges. So what do these three legs of the academy in the educational experience, what is accomplished? What kind of outcomes can we see in the lives of students? Well, taken together, these experiences, this kind of a learning structure at schools like North Park and Dominican often produce outcomes that we think are deeply, deeply important, not just for preparing people for the workplace, which yes, we do, but also in preparing our students and our graduates for life. What we do is important. Who we are is critical. What do I mean? Let me illustrate in a few ways. An education at a liberal arts college broadens the mind. It connects to this notion of needing to have a breadth of education before you start digging too deeply. We deeply believe in the outcome that is produced along these lines. Undergraduate education at schools like ours promotes an intellectual diversity rather than an intellectual isolation. An education at a liberal arts college also fosters integrated learning and thinking. Or consider it this way, what we're looking for is intellectual cross-training. Students who venture into numerous fields of knowledge as undergraduates, as they enter a program, are the kind who are prepared for and capable of working with others. They know how it is to bring what they have to a table, share it with others, learn from others who are on the same table, and then together create something new that none of them individually could well have accomplished. The workplace requires this kind of team and the effort that can come through it, and I'd like to say society at large requires this kind of team as well. Beyond this, an education at liberal arts colleges challenges the big sort. Let me play with that one for just a little bit. A man by the name of Bill Bishop, a sociologist and journalist, writes that across the United States, the dominant tendency is for communities to be comprised of like-minded people. He calls this the big sort. He's written a book by the same name. What I want to do is read one paragraph from this book, catch on to the fact that this was written by him a bit over a decade ago. I think it's tremendously relevant today. We have built a country where everyone can choose the neighbors, the church, and the news shows most compatible with his or her lifestyle and beliefs. and we are living with the consequences of this segregation by way of life. Pockets of like-minded citizens that have become so ideologically inbred that we don't know, can't understand, and can barely conceive of those people who live just a few miles away, or in a city, maybe even just a few blocks away. Not so, or at least less so, for graduates of liberal arts colleges. When students of many races and ethnicities, Donna's already talked about this, when students of many races and ethnicities come together, live and learn side by side 24/7 for multiple years, in the end, they are better prepared for life. Life in a world of increasing diversity and increasing global engagement. In such a world, students must have figured out their own identities, but they must also be skilled at communicating with people who are different from themselves, and they have to be able to build bridges, bridges across cultural difference, bridges that are built in the very significant transition to a more diverse society that is characteristic of our life today. One of the best hopes for breaking down the effects of the big sort is education. The sort of education, no pun intended there, that's fostered by liberal arts colleges. And the last thing to note is that liberal arts colleges prepare graduates for civic participation. We are those who send people into the community to learn from the community, and as a result, they develop a commitment to doing so over the course of time. Clustered together, these are the kinds of outcomes fostered by schools like Dominican, North Park, those with the Associated College of Universities of Illinois that, in fact, make a difference in the lives of students. Thank you.
Thank you very much, President Parkyn. If you have a question to ask, just hold up your question. Members of our staff will pick them up. We'll try to answer as many as we can. Also, when people came in, if you put your business card into our fishbowl, we will have a drawing at the end of the program. If you haven't put it in, if one of our staff people is out there, if you could bring that bowl in and collect some more cards, you're more than welcome to do that. While Amanda from our staff, do you have a question, sir?
No.
Okay, I saw that blue card going into your pocket. Okay, good. You think we don't see that up here. Let me ask our panelists to respond to a question that was submitted to us. How can a liberal arts education help grow tomorrow's workforce? Donna, maybe you want to respond, and then
sure.
David, very briefly.
David mentioned the diversity pipeline. I think we are enormous contributor to that. Our character development fosters leadership, and so the numbers of CEOs and well-placed individuals with liberal arts degrees are significant. But what I focus on is the word tomorrow. We know that a good practical professional education can prepare you for a first job. A liberal arts education prepares you with the flexibility and the resilience, the critical thinking, the good judgment, the communication skills that prepare you for the job we don't even know yet exists. And that makes us tremendously proud.
One of the
Thank you, David.
One of the challenges we face in Illinois is that more students leave North Park to study elsewhere than come from other places to study in Illinois. There's a net negative effect to that, and that's challenging for the workforce because students often remain for life where they attend college. There is a relationship there. So one of the things that we all work on in higher education today, and you can help promote here, is for one of the ways to improve the workforce in Illinois is to keep more and more students in Illinois studying at schools here that are present here, in large measure because through the educational experiences that we have on campuses like ours, we connect students. Students are connected with the community around them, businesses around them, and through internships and civic engagement and other experiences like that, students begin to expand the roots that helps them to eventually stay present in Illinois. So doing the job well is important, and then making sure that students come from and remain in Illinois is important to us as well.
Thank you. John Atkinson, City Club member with Willis Towers Watson. John, where are you? Right over here to my left. There are recent reports that President-elect Trump will take action to rescind the executive order protecting DACA kids, D-A-C-A, as soon as tomorrow. How are your institutions preparing to support these students? You have seniority, President.
On December 15th, the Board of Trustees of Dominican University formally approved the campus as a sanctuary campus. We've posted that resolution. It is a particular concern to Dominican, where almost 10% of our undergraduate student body is undocumented. It is a deeply, deeply mission-centered initiative, and we will do all that we can within the limits of the law, which is larger than people sometimes recognize, to protect and support our students.
It's a deep challenge. DACA students have, by becoming DACA students, they have self-identified, which means that their families are identified as well. One of the challenges that we also face is not just on the part of the students who are on our campus, but the concern that students have for their families. It may well be that DACA students are less at risk and their families are more at risk. I don't want to equivocate too much on that, but it would be one thing to ask adults to leave the country, require them to leave the country. Quite another thing for a young person who's studying successfully at a college, require them to leave the country. Both would be devastating to the well-being of DACA students on our campuses.
Thank you very much. This question is from City Club member Robin Steens. Robin, right here, down in front. You both have been stalwart champions of, this is called bear trapping. You have both been stalwart champions of college access and completion for first-time low-income minority students. What impact is the budget impasse, I assume in Springfield, having on that mission?
Yeah, the impact is very, very significant for our students and eventually for our institutions. I want to step back for a moment and first of all speak for all of higher education in Illinois, okay? All of education in Illinois is affected by the MAP grant and its availability or not. This is a grant that provides support for lower income students. And on our campuses and campuses across the state, these are significant numbers of students. And without MAP, either a student isn't able to pay their bill, thereby they drop out of school, or an institution has to backfill, cover for that in one way or another. Simply the two choices. I think it's what we have done at North Park with our students is over the last 2 years, commit to cover if the state doesn't cover. We can do that for a short run, I suppose. To date, we haven't been in the negative. We haven't had to do that because eventually the state has come through. Last year, this year, it's ambiguous. But we certainly can't pay out year after year along those lines. What would hurt us, of course, is not just that MAP is not with us and those students aren't with us, but whatever other income comes from those students would not be part of our financial environment either. What would really hurt is those students simply wouldn't be with us. For state institutions, for others beyond the privates, the state budget crisis is much, much larger than what I've just described for the privates. State schools also receive MAP grants through their students. but of course state institutions receive other allocation from the state, build their budgets around that, and are frankly in a very, very difficult position as well. So all of us in education care very, very deeply about the state budget crisis. And frankly, one of the challenges that we also face that you don't feel overtly, though, is that increasingly students are choosing to study out of state because the incentive to remain in state just isn't there. And this kind of budget crisis at the state level makes it so that students love Illinois less than they might.
You know, it's the not knowing and the not deciding that is the most insidious, both for the institution and for the individual student. You know, the MAP eligible student is the most vulnerable financially. And so unless there's the opportunity to plan, to respond, to incorporate that into a family budget, it can cause a student, and I would argue it can cause a generation of students to drop out of higher education. 4,700 a year gets over 130,000 students a college education. If that education is not accessible in the private sector, the cost of that education, which is about $18,000 per student, goes into the state deficit. So we need to resolve it. And I guess the one final thing I would say, it is goddamn bad role modeling. You know, it's not, excuse me, as the Catholic president, it's not what we should be teaching our students about integrity and leadership and responsibility for the future. It is irresponsible.
Thank you both. This is from William Davies from GSU, Governor State University. Bill, where are you? Right down here. Great. How are your universities dealing with the exporting from Illinois of college students? He says it's second in the nation. Mm-hmm. So I guess part of the question also is, how do we keep young people here after graduation?
More and more undergraduates are getting their first job as a consequence of the internship they have while they're in college. So one of the best strategies is for us to work together to tie students to job-related experiences, corporations, communities, not-for-profit, while they're in college, so that they step into those first jobs with a sense of commitment to the company and to the state.
One of the things we've chosen to do at North Park is to leverage our location. Chicago is a great city. It's got its challenges quite clearly, but it's a great place to study. It's a great place to learn. And at North Park, what we've chosen to do is develop more and more of an effort to embrace Chicago as our classroom, to develop programs on campus where students can overtly see a connection between an education at North Park and our location in the city of Chicago. Our hope in doing that is to address many things, but this sense of where do I get my first job, which is a very significant driving factor for students, a sense that there's potential for a good answer on graduation, if in fact they do the kinds of things that Donna suggested and that I mentioned in some of my comments too, about connecting to the work environment in the city of Chicago, also participating in civic life and the like, volunteering in the nonprofit world. Those are all ways of making connections for our students. And if we can suggest to students of Illinois that studying on campuses like ours, because of our location, has value, then we hopefully will be successful in contributing against, drawing down on the negative effect of students leaving Illinois to study elsewhere. We know it happens for us in terms of things international. International students study on both of our campuses. Why do they come here? Because they know Dominican or they know North Park? No, they know Chicago. So they come and find us by virtue of where we're located. I'd like to think that students who are residents of Illinois can discover some of the same.
Absolutely. The next time you're up at Foster and Ketzi, if you're looking for some great Swedish pancakes with lingonberries, the Trey Kroner, just go in and tell them that President Parkyn sent you. You'll get your discount. This is from Mike Vasilko. Mike, where are you? Way in the back. He is a higher education architect. News is that enrollment for most colleges and universities is flat or down. Put on your crystal balls. Do you see this trend continuing?
It doesn't much take a crystal ball. We can look at enrollments at high school and elementary levels. The data are pretty clearly out there, find them pretty easily, that within the Midwest, the number of students graduating from high school over recent years and on into the next 10 or 15 years will continue to slip downward. There's also a more significant trend, though, and that is how that effect plays out in populations that have historically gone to college and those that have not. It's one of the reasons why there's a rapidly changing demographic on our campuses, because there's a steep decline in the population of students who have traditionally, from families that have traditionally gone to college, and an increase, actually, in activity and graduation from high school in other populations. The same thing holds true to an even greater extent in New England and the Mid-Atlantic states, less so in Florida. If you want to run a college, be in Florida these days. Population's growing there. So it has some to do with geographic factors across America, but generally speaking, in terms of the traditional age population, in the aggregate, we won't largely see an increase unless we have more and more access to higher education, which is clearly something that both of our institutions and ACI institutions and schools across the state are committed to and have active interest in.
Right. I think the issue is affordability as much as it is numbers. And it's shaping a curriculum, it's constantly reshaping a curriculum to meet workforce demand without losing your soul as a liberal arts institution. And I think where you're seeing the most volatility in enrollments in universities right now is at the graduate professional level. Because we have not, since the recession of 2008, 9, 10, graduate professional education, the demand for it is now very different. It's more badge related, it's more skill specific, it's less degree driven. And universities are still adapting to that new dynamic. And until we adapt to that dynamic at the graduate level and really wrestle deeply together with the affordability issue, we're not going to be able to maximize the available quality education for students.
Okay, we have time for two more questions. First one is from C.T. Smith. C.T., where are you? Right over here. Thank you. He wants to know what percentage of liberal arts students go and attend grad school versus entering the workforce. Is this evolving, or do you think it's constant?
Well, liberal arts students are as different as any other segment of students, and liberal arts colleges differ. We have about 30% of our undergraduate students that continue on to graduate school. We see another percentage that come back in 3 to 5 years for a second degree. We see an increasing number that are marrying curriculum and experience differently. They may be going to a two-year college for 2 years with the intent of coming to Dominican for 3 years because they're accelerating into a BS MBA program. So it's a complicated question. Undergraduate research, the faculty mentorship that you get in a liberal arts college does continue to produce, however, a segment of students who become Donnas and Davids someday.
Yeah, very good. David, do you have a comment on that? Or?
Well, graduate education, the availability of graduate education got me out of the sewer lines. So there are some benefits to it. Yeah, I think Donna's, I follow Donna's line of thinking here. Students are different from one to the another. It may not necessarily be students going directly from undergraduate to graduate programs. There can be intervening time there. And it's also not the case that graduate education has to be full-time. It can well be undertaken, as is the experience with many of us, no doubt. It can be undertaken during a period of employment as well. So these things, you can probably measure it in the course of 15 years after graduation, but not so much in the course of a year or a year and a half or 2 years after graduation.
Okay, and our final question comes from John Brooks. John, where are you? Right over here to my right. And I'm going to, as chairman, exercise prerogative and join your question. Yesterday at President Obama's final news conference with the press, he was asked about the possibility of the next African-American president. And in his response, he said, "We are in a country where people have the right to vote, but not enough people exercise that right." I assume he was referring to the November election. How does a liberal arts education contribute to the building of an engaged citizenry? President Carroll.
That is the core of who we are. And it's built upon the broad and deep integrated education that we provide, the strong social justice mission of many of our institutions, the strong experiential learning, volunteer experiences that students have while in school. And I say this because sometimes it's painful, the level of engagement and activism campuses allow when you are relationship-centered and students care. We are going through a particularly volatile time around the ladder because of the election, because of the changing dynamics. And I will say, taking a deep breath, it's a good thing. It is a challenging experience when you're in leadership because students' window of opportunity for change is tight. But if we can provide that space, those opportunities, that education in a campus environment that is forgiven, where students can make mistakes, they can know that they are still loved, they can try again, we will educate stronger citizens, students that are more prepared to deal with those complex situations, more invested, and then more likely to vote.
Thank you. President Parkyn?
Well, just to bring back to, this is why we approach education the way we do, the three-legged stool, if you want, or describe it in different ways. It's what Donna was talking about. We think that that type of education does more than, it prepares students for the workplace, but does more than that, prepares students for life, for engagement in community, and our deep hope, I think there's good research that suggests that students who graduate from schools like ours, because of the level of engagement in the process of learning and the experiences that are associated with that, do in fact develop over the course of a lifetime into the kind of citizens that we're looking for.
Let us, we still have two items of business, but let's show our appreciation for this enlightening program.